Hi everyone, this is Chris Duffy from the think tank by Adobe. I'm joined by Kathryn Hume from Integrate.ai. We spent the last couple of days chatting about all things AI, so we're thrilled to have you here to continue the conversation.
Yeah, it was a wonderful day. So
you know, first topic potentially is about your background. You have a fascinating background, this really interesting intersection of the arts with your literature background, but also mathematics. And I think that's a great reflection of what artificial intelligence is in some ways, this marriage of art and science.
Yeah, I got really lucky. I must say, when I was doing my PhD in literature, I never imagined that 5 or 6 years later I'd end up in the position that I'm in, and B, that my training and thinking critically about how cultures struggle with adopting new technologies would be as useful as it is for the work in AI.
Sure.
But it's been great and helps me think about the ethical issues, technologies, et cetera.
So how are you applying that background and what you do to the future of AI in the enterprise space?
Sure, so we talked a lot yesterday about this not just being about technology, but always being about the magical mixture between humans and machines.
Sure.
And going beyond just optimization to thinking about ways to use technology to enhance our creativity or do creative things.
Yeah.
And so for me at Integrate, we're focused on everything that is customer experience, customer journeys, helping enterprises apply AI to deliver better experiences to customers. And a lot of that starts with not, all right, what's our metric and how can we improve it? That's important from a programmatic perspective, but more, who are our customers? How do they feel? Where do they live? And what does it mean to think about how we can use technology to engage with them more impactfully?
And we chatted a bit about magical, right? The notion that, you know, the technology is not magical in of itself. It's what it delivers in terms of the experience. How are you approaching that?
It's interesting. I'm of two minds regarding thinking about AI like magic. On the one hand, I think it's really important to empower organizations to have them know that it's just math.
Yeah.
You know? So to the extent, I think math's magical, but most people are kind of like, no, math's not, it's kind of boring.
Sure.
But on the other hand, I think just the ability to create, like if you're thinking about being a consumer, and suddenly you go from having to go and fill out forms and being frustrated with an interface and just like making it so hard to tap into the value of a business,
sure,
to somewhere where it feels like, without being creepy, right, the business knows you, empathizes you, and creates something that can make your life more meaningful. Like for me, that's sort of where the magic lies.
Yeah. And so much about these magical moments are driven by data. Maybe we chat a little bit about the responsibility that entails to deploy that.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's say you, as a white male, privileged white male, and who has a heart but happens to be born the way that you were, you might have a magical experience, but somebody who's an African-American woman, older woman, because the system's been trained on data, there might be a lot of customers like you, so they're really great for you, but they're really not great for her. Right, so when we think about creating magical experiences, we have to think about magic for everyone and not just people that are well represented in the data. And so it's just important that we don't replicate some of the stuff that we've inherited from the past, but think about who our users are across the board. And for me, here's where the magic comes in. As opposed to seeing that as an obstacle and like fearing bias and fearing AI in terms of liabilities, what if we think about it as new market development? What if like there's the realm of African American grandmas is an untapped market for a business and can lead to huge returns on investment, right? So,
you know, speaking of the future of AI in the enterprise, I think you mentioned a kind of a bold statement that we're moving beyond rules-based AI into some new forms. Would you like to chat a little bit about that?
Yeah, for sure. So I just gave a talk about building an enterprise AI culture. And really love how Jeff Bezos phrases it, where he says, we used to be able to automate things where we could clearly say, if this happens, then that happens. And that's great when we're doing sort of analytics and counting and wanting to know how a Twitter campaign has performed. When we go to the world of AI, we can basically make an educated guess that something might be the case. And the cool thing is there's a lot of things that are more fuzzy like that. And like that's where creativity comes from.
Awesome.
Right? Because it's not that this needs be the case, but hey, if we tweak that and add this variation in parameter, we get this sort of beautiful new thing.
Yeah.
problem is it can be really hard for businesses to manage probabilities because it's hard to say how much, what's the ROI going to be? What does this product look like? What are the risks? They have to design experiments and get a lot of feedback. So it's sort of a, it's a different mode of operating, but that can lead to unexpected but really amazing returns.
I think one thing that we also collectively agreed on at the think tank is the future is going to be changing not only drastically, but even faster than ever before. And there was this notion of creative elasticity, meaning that the one thing that we can predict with certainty is that we have to go into it with kind of agility and knowing that the land marketplace is going to be changing. Any thoughts on
honestly,
that as well?
For me, this goes back to your first question. So, you know, my background in math and comparative literature, I believe that having a sound liberal arts education and being a critical thinker who is always questioning the status quo, always sitting there and asking what really matters, how things might change, and actually is a way to build a sort of an agile and adaptive mindset. And it's very different than learning one skill and going and specializing and knowing how to do one thing really well. I think there still will be room for really deep specialists in the future, but I think the role of the generalist who's able to adapt, right? And might not be the best at one thing, but is good enough at many things, which is kind of the opposite of AI. AIs are idiot savants, they're not Renaissance men. So I actually think it's pretty cool that we humans get to explore our curiosity and just dabble in different domains and let the machines take care of the stuff that's all sort of one-track minded.
And how do you define artificial intelligence? We chatted a little bit about that yesterday as well.
Oh yeah, for sure. In a way that's playful and provocative. So I think it's whatever computers can't do until they can. And this was my former colleague Hillary Mason first introduced me to this phrase. I think it dates back to a science fiction writer. And I love it because the tech is changing so quickly. It goes into agility, right? We can't define it precisely because tomorrow it's going to be able to do stuff that it couldn't yesterday. So you have to just bake all that progress into the definition and recognize that we're always in this limbo related to our own superiority or specialness as humans, right? It's kind of it adds humility.
And in closing, if there's one place to start, where would you recommend an enterprise start?
So what's interesting, I was talking with your colleague about this, and I think the real value that AI can provide is it actually empowers the customer to shape their experience with the business as opposed to just sort of receiving what's been given to them. So then you say, all right, where do you start to get there? I think it starts with picking existing business metrics, finding one that where if you were to modify it a little bit, it could lead to huge returns. So you'd only have to get like little wins to have big results. And that helps get executive buy-in. That helps people go from like, oh, there's this thing in the research lab to like, whoa, this is really valuable for my business. And then from that, you can get into some of the more complex things around personalization and like lifetime value optimization. But it starts with like a tweak on what's happening today in a meaningful way using data.
Wonderful. Great way to end it. Thanks, everyone, for joining. Please check us out at hashtag Adobe TT. Thanks again.